In this lecture, we will be studying the concept of generalized single degree of freedom systems. Up to now, we were studying the dynamics of simple structures, and those were single degree of freedom systems. And we were calculating the response of different applied loadings, dynamic loadings. We were calculating the response of single degree of freedom system against these dynamic loadings. Then we also calculated the earthquake response of single degree of freedom systems. Now in this lecture, I will show that some relatively complex structures can also be treated and analyzed approximately as single degree of freedom systems. So those will be called as the generalized single degree of freedom systems. So let us start, and let's see that here we have three examples of complex structures. Here in the first figure, figure A, we have an assemblage of rigid bodies. You have two masses MA and MB, and they are connected with a rigid element, and this element is having some lateral stiffness KC and KD, and also having the damping property, and that is this dashpot, represented by this dashpot. The element itself, which is connecting these two masses MA and MB, that element is rigid. So it can deflect only laterally like this, in this manner. Those are represented by these dotted lines. So these are the deflected shapes, and that line will be always straight because the connecting element is rigid. So it is an assemblage of rigid bodies. It is a complex structure compared to a single degree of freedom system, which we used to calculate the response against different dynamic loadings. In figure B, you have a system with distributed mass and flexibility. And here you have a tower structure, and the mass is not lumped at any location. It is just distributed along the height axis, which is x-axis. And also the stiffness is also distributed along the height. So now the displacement will not be at a particular location. I mean, the mass is not lumped at that location. The displacement will be a continuous displacement, and that is represented as u, which is the function of x also, as well as time. So this is basically a distributed mass and flexibility system. And ideally, you can solve it by assuming that the mass is lumped at infinite points along the height. So it is basically an infinite degree of freedom structure. So the exact theory of the distributed mass and flexibility structures or systems is also available. But this is a complex structure compared to the single degree of freedom system, which we have just solved. Another complex structure is what we called as a shear building, and here also the mass is lumped at different levels, but it is not a continuous variation of mass and stiffness. In fact, the mass is lumped at several fixed locations. These locations, the mass is lumped, and the lateral stiffness is also lumped, and the lateral stiffness of all of these stories is K1 up to K4, the mass is M1 up to M4. So the displacement is also for each story is U1, U2, U3 and U4. The displacement also will be at these four points. So this is a structure with finite degrees of freedom, but it is a complex structure. It is sometimes referred to as a multi-story shear building. The mass is lumped at several locations, generally the floor levels, and stiffness is also lumped at each story separately. So the mass and stiffness are not distributed in a continuous manner, just like this tower. All of these complex systems can be treated or solved as single degree of freedom systems, and that obviously that treatment and that analysis will be approximate analysis. So we can convert these complex systems into we can treat them as single degree of freedom systems or generalized single degree of freedom systems. So the basic idea is that the deflections u, which is the function of x as well as t of the complex systems, can be related to a single generalized displacement, which is denoted here as z function of time, through a shape function, which is xi function of x as shown. And now we can express the displacement or describe the displacement, which is varying both in x and time. We can describe it as a product of a shape function and the z, which is the single generalized displacement. So let me explain that concept, and then that will we can apply that to all three kinds of complex structures which we have just seen. Let's say that you have a structure with which is a, you can say, a fixed assemblage, a rigid assemblage of two masses m1 and m2. So here you have m1 and m2, and they are connected by a rigid rod or a rigid element. Some force is applied, p of t, mass and stiffness is given, and the damping is also given. Now, because since this is a rigid element, this element which is connecting m1 and m2 and this support, so the displacement of this whole structure can only be in this manner, that if this line is the undeformed shape, then this line is the deformed shape. So the displacement is practically constrained only in one particular way or one particular shape. So that shape is called the shape function, and that is denoted here as the xi of x. So let me call it as shape of vibration. Shape of vibration. So in this particular figure A, since the rod is rigid, so the shape of vibration is this straight line, and the equation for straight line is, you can say that this xi of x is simply x. So it is a linear line like this. If the horizontal line is the, you can say, original shape, the deflected shape will be just a linear line, and the equation of linear line we know already, that if we have this xi on y axis, so, and x axis is this one, so this equation will be xi of x will be simply equal to x. So this is the shape of movement or shape of vibration. Under this p of t, which is a dynamic load, the shape will be just a fluctuation between this line and this line. This will be just to and fro motion in this manner. And whatever the p of t will be at a particular instant, the shape of deflected shape of this rod will be somewhere between this line and the bottom line, which is the red line. So what we have done essentially here is that we have just fixed one particular shape of vibration. We just constrained the structure such that it can only have one shape of vibration. So if the shape of vibration we assume, or we constrain our structure to only have that particular shape, then what we can do is that we can fix it, and then the time variation of that particular shape can be represented by another generalized displacement, that is z of t. So their product basically at any particular time will give us the deflection, variation of deflection along the length, actual deflection. Similarly, here you have a beam which is having distributed mass. Now the mass is also a function of x, where x is this axis, and ei, which is the stiffness of the beam, is also a function of x. So ei is also distributed. It is different at different x values. So this is a distributed mass structure. Under any applied force, let's say this is the p of t, the deflected shape of the build, this structure can be described by this function, which is xi of x. And if we write this ux comma t as a product of this xi of x times z of t, because z of t will be just one function, which is a time function, and time function is multiplied by a shape. So basically, this whole product is a shape which is fluctuating in time domain. So the shape is being multiplied by a time function. So basically, whatever shape we assume, whatever xi of x we assume, z of t will be fluctuation of that particular shape. So if we can just fix this shape of vibration, then this z of t will represent the displacement of an generalized single degree of freedom system. It is possible to obtain approximate results that are accurate to a useful degree by restricting the deflections of the beam to a single shape function. So if we know already that this xi of x is the shape of vibration and this is the only shape which the structure or beam can have, then we can use this information to treat the whole system as a single degree of freedom system, because the, you can say, the distribution of the vibration along the length axis is already fixed, and all we need to calculate is the time distribution or the temporal distribution of the displacement. So the distribution of displacement and different locations of the beam is already described by this shape of vibration. So we have to just calculate this z of t, and that product will basically tell us the displaced shape or deformed shape at any particular time instant of the forced vibration response. We can also calculate the other properties of that generalized single degree of freedom system also based on this idea. I will explain it further also, this concept. So the idea is that if the deformation of any complex system can be approximately described as u of x comma t, u is the function of both the length of the element or height of the element as well as time. What you can do is that along the length you fix the shape, and only the variable remain will be time. And the distribution, the time distribution of that shape or fluctuation in time for that particular shape is described by another variable, which is z of t. So this xi of t will be a shape function, or it is a dimensionless function. It will basically give you the shape of vibration basically. So if you fix it, you assume some function which you think is appropriately representing the shape of vibration, then you have to only calculate this z of t. For continuous structures, this equation will hold, but if you have a structure with distributed with lumped masses at different levels, then this deformed shape will not be a function of x, where x is now height of the structure. Deformed shape will be just a vector containing the values or ordinates which is describing the deformed shape. So the displacement at roof, the displacement at a lower story, the other displacements at lower stories, all of these numbers basically will be arranged in that manner in a vector, and that vector will represent the original deformed shape which we have assumed. The structure will be assumed to have only that shape which we fix for it. Basically, we constrain our structure to have that shape, and that information will help us in converting a complex structure into a generalized single degree of freedom system. We can solve that single degree of freedom system, and the results can again be you can say traced back to the original complex structure. So for the case C, which is the shear building, you will not have this equation. Basically, you will have ui, where I is the story number. So ui of t will be the value of that vector at that story, which is basically xi I times z of t, where z of t is a function describing the time fluctuation of that particular shape which we have assumed. So the basic concept is that if we can describe the deformed shape in this manner, or in the shear building case in this manner, then it can be shown that the governing equation of motion of each of those complex systems will be having this form. That will be having this form, that now z of t will be your main variable, and the masses of those complex system, the c value and the k also stiffness will be now modified. So this m prime, c prime and k prime are the modified mass, damping and stiffness, or in this case it is called the generalized mass, generalized damping and generalized stiffness of the system. They are the properties of a generalized single degree of freedom system, which is representing that complex structure. Similarly, the loading will also be a modified loading, and P prime is now the generalized force vector, the generalized force for that single degree of freedom system. We will prove it for one case, and then we can just use it for all complex structures. For applied dynamic force case, we will have the governing equation of motion for generalized single degree of freedom system in this form. For ground motion case, we will have this equation, and here we will have a new factor which is called the generalized force factor. So this L prime is the generalized force factor for ground motion case, and that L prime is also defined in next slide. So the basic idea is that if we can fix the shape of deformation, and we only just assume that this shape is fluctuating in a manner which is described by z of t, then that z of t can be calculated using this equation. Basically, the governing equation of motion for that complete system can be just reduced to this equation, and that equation is the equation of a single degree of freedom system. It represents a single degree of freedom system with a different modified mass, a different or modified damping, and a different k value. And with these different values of mass, damping and stiffness, this single degree of freedom system will have a deformation equal to z of t, and that z of t can be put here in the same equation, or here on the top, and that can be converted to ux of t. ux, t is basically the actual displacement of the structure along the height or along the length axis. So let's see that how we can use this idea of fixing or assuming a particular shape value or shape function, and then using it to construct a generalized single degree of freedom system. So here the procedure which we will be performing is applicable to either the rigid assemblages or the mass, distributed mass and distributed stiffness structures, or it can also be applied to a shear building. So shear building can also be handled. The analysis procedures which we have used to analyze or perform the dynamic analysis of simple single degree of freedom systems, they can now be directly used if we calculate the modified mass, the modified damping and modified stiffness of these complex structures, because then we will be basically converting them into a single degree of freedom system, and we already know how to solve single degree of freedom system. So that z of t can be calculated from the single degree of freedom analysis, and then put it back in that equation to calculate the actual u x comma t. Obviously, the accuracy of this whole procedure which we are going to study now depends on this function which we use or which we fix or assume, because this is the function or the shape of vibration which we are going to fix, and the structure should actually deform or modify, or basically you can say displace only in that particular shape. If the structure is going to deform in any other shape, then this procedure will not be accurate. So the procedure which we are going to study now will give us the exact results for this case A. And the reason is that we actually know how is the shape of vibration. So we actually know here that this xi of x is equal to x. So therefore, if we put that back in the main equation, this u of x t will be equal to x times z. So if we convert this system A into a generalized single degree of freedom system, since we actually know what is the actual deflection shape, and this system, since this beam or this rod is rigid element, so therefore it cannot have any other shape other than these these two extreme positions. It cannot deform like this. It also, in the other side also, it cannot deform because it is a rigid element. So therefore here we have a case where we exactly know the shape of vibration. So if we have this accurate xi of x, this procedure of converting this system into equivalent single degree of freedom system and then solving that system will become an exact analysis. But here in this case B, we don't know the exact shape of vibration. This, under the applied load, can vibrate in this manner. In this manner, it can vibrate in to and fro manner. It can also vibrate in this manner, that the tip of the beam is going in upward direction, but the middle is going in the other direction. So there can be several shapes of this distributed mass system. Several shapes are possible, and we will fix it to one shape only, that will be represented by this xi of x. So therefore, the method will be approximate method for this case B. Similarly, for shear building also, since we have to assume a particular shape of vibration, and that we don't know exact shape right from start, so therefore the process will be approximate. But for this case A, since the assembly is such that it can only vibrate in one possible shape, and that shape is described by this function, and if we can use that function in this method which we are going to study, the analysis will lead us to exact results. But for other two cases, it will be approximate method. So let me first tell you the modified mass, modified stiffness, and modified damping, and that the shape, the applied force factor L prime for all of these three systems. So the system A, which was a rigid body assemblage, you will have the modified mass, which will be coming from MA and MB, and that will be the function of xi of x. Obviously, these modified mass, stiffness, and damping, they will be the function of that actual shape of vibration which you have assumed in the start. So you have to assume a shape of vibration in the start, and then that shape will be used to calculate the modified mass, stiffness, and damping for the generalized single degree of freedom system, which is representing the complete complex system. So if you have this kind of an assembly, you will have the M prime equal to MA times this xi square, but the value of xi at XA. So you will have different distances defined as XA, which is from bottom up to the mass A. XB is from bottom up to mass B. XC is from bottom up to the point at which there is the first spring or source of stiffness. And XD is the distance of the second source of stiffness, KD. XE is basically the distance from bottom up to the damper. So all of these distances are known because the actual geometry of the structure is known. And we assume a deformed shape. And that deformed shape will be simply a linear line, because this is a pin support at the base. So it will simply a linear line, and we can calculate the modified mass, or basically we can calculate the ordinates of this deformed shape at different levels. So this number, right from this number up to the mass, this number is basically represented as xi of XA. Xi of XA means this distance, the deformed shape which is assumed, the peak value at the top or at the tip of that structure. Similarly, we can calculate that number at any level, or any you can say X value, XA, B, C, D. and we call them as xi xa, xi xb, xi xe, c and d also. So all you need to have the original masses, the original stiffnesses kc and kd, and the original damping coefficient. To calculate the modified masses, the modified damping coefficient and the modified stiffness, and also the force factor L prime, that is also a function of masses, and the value of that assumed function, assumed shape of vibration at different, you can say, levels xc and xb. One important point here is that since this xi of x is the shape of vibration, its absolute values doesn't matter. So its shape of vibration, so you can use because the relative values between these different points in on that shape, their relative value matter. So you can normalize that shape such that the peak value may be equal to 1 and all of the other values will be relative to that peak value. So xi of x is a function which is, I repeat again, that it is describing the shape of vibration. So its absolute values you don't need, you just need their relative values. So for system A, you can calculate the modified mass, stiffness and damping using these equations. And similarly, for a system which is having a distributed mass and distributed EI value, so now EI is not a constant number, it is function of x, and mass is also not a constant number, it is a function of x. It is varying along the x-axis. So you can use these equations, the integration of m of x and the shape of vibration square function, shape function, and that will be integrated to calculate the mass, and integration is from 0 to L, where L is the total height of that element or structure. Similarly, K can be calculated and L also can be calculated. Now here you have a new expression. This xi double prime here is basically the double derivative of xi function with respect to x. So it is d2 xi of x d over dx square. So xi double prime of x is the second derivative with respect to x. So we will be using dot to represent the derivative with respect to time, but we will be using prime to represent the derivative with respect to x. So we know already that the double derivative of any displacement is basically the curvature. So this is in fact curvature of this structure at any particular x. We will derive these expressions for, I think, system B, but then we will just use them for any structure. Similarly, for system C, which is also a multiple degree of freedom system, but not a continuous structure, it is having the mass lumped at fixed positions and stiffness also is fixed at different stories. So it is not like a continuous structure. It has a finite degrees of freedom. You need to have that shape of vibration function or shape function in order to calculate these modified properties. So these modified properties depend on that shape function. Whatever function you assume or constrain your structure to vibrate in, that function will basically used in calculation of the modified mass, modified damping and modified stiffness. How we come up with these expressions for a real structure, I will show you in for one of the case, and I will explain a general method to calculate these modified mass, stiffness and damping, etc. But then you can use the same method to come up with these values for any other kind of structure, for any structure. So if you apply that method to this structure, you will come up with these equations. If you apply it to some other structure, some other assembly, the equations will be changed. So for the shear building case, the modified mass, modified stiffness and modified force factor will be basically the function of that assumed shape vector. So now in this case, this xi is not a function of x, it is basically a vector now, which will be having the numbers for each of the story. So if you draw or connect them or plot those numbers, you will get the deformed shape. So that will becomes your basically shape or xi of x. So if you know the value of this xi of x at each story or all of these numbers in this vector, then you can use this. Obviously now the mass and stiffness is not distributed, so the integrals are now replaced by summations. So you will have any jth story, you have its mass and multiply the value of the xi vector at that particular jth story. So if j is equal to 1, then you will have m1 and the first entry of this vector square plus m2 and second entry, m3 and third entry, and you will go up to m4 and the fourth entry. So this xi vector will be having four numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, and those will be basically the ordinates of this assumed deflected shape at each story. So similarly, if kj is the story of one column, which is it is one story, the stiffness of one story, which is summation of all the columns, then you can have kj times this whole thing, and j is 1 to n, where n is the number of stories. Similarly, the force, the modified force factor also can be calculated, this L prime. So the idea is that if the vibration shape is given or assumed, and the distribution of mass and flexibility or the stiffness is also given for the complex system, it is possible to evaluate all of these generalized properties of the system. So all you need to know is the deformed shape, the assumed deformed shape, and the original m, k, and c, etc. And then you can use these properties to calculate the m prime, k prime, and c prime, and l prime also. So which means that you can effectively convert a complex structure into an equivalent single degree of freedom system, having the time, you can say, variation, or having the response which is equal to z of t. So you calculate z of t for these modified m, k, c, etc. And then you use the same expression, u of x comma t is equal to xi of x into z of t. So xi of x is already known, you assumed it right at the start. So z of t is calculated from single degree of freedom system. So you can calculate u of u as a function of x and t. So this is the overall idea. Now the issue is to calculate these modified mass, modified stiffness, and modified force vector. And also the issue is about how we can fix this shape function or shape of vibration at the start. The accuracy of this generalized single degree of freedom system formulation, it depends on the assumed shape function. So if you use an accurate shape function, for example, in the first case, which I give you an example here, case A, we know already the exact shape of the vibration. So therefore, if we use the generalized single degree of freedom concept for this case A, we will get the exact displacement, actual displacement. But if we apply the same concept for this distributed mass system or shear building, then the process will be approximate, and that will be depend on how accurate this shape function which we have assumed in the start. If the shape function is accurate, or the actual vibration also have the same shape, then this process will be accurate. Otherwise, it will be just approximate method. So in order to calculate these distributed mass the distributed K and modified mass, modified K and modified C value, or in fact I should call them as generalized mass, generalized K and generalized C value, and also L value. For the ground motion case, we have this L factor also. In order to calculate that, let's first assume the distributed mass and the distributed elasticity structure, and we will only be considering the ground motion case directly. But obviously, the applied force case can also be handled in a similar manner. So I have already shown you the equations for these factors or these constants, and those equations depend on the original mass, the original K and the original C, and also more importantly it depends on the xi of x function which we assumed. So we need to have values of xi of x at different x values in order to calculate these numbers for generalized single degree of freedom system. So let's derive those same equations which I just showed you for the case of distributed mass and distributed elasticity, and let's say that structure is now subjected to ground shaking. So this UG is applied at the base, and the structure have mass M of X and stiffness EI of X, which is distributed along the x-axis. X-axis is the vertical axis. L is the total length of this structure or this tower. So we will be using basically the principle of virtual displacements to come up with the equation of motion for this tower. And that equation of motion will be same as when we derive it, we will see that it will look like the equation of motion of a single degree of freedom system. So this is our tower, and we will just give it some virtual displacements, and we will equate the internal work done with the external work done in displacing that tower, and that equation will give us the equation of motion for this system. That equation of motion will look like the equation of a single degree of freedom system, and from there we will get the idea of this generalized single degree of freedom system. Although actually it is a very complex structure because it is having infinite degrees of freedom, so it is having infinite points of masses, and each mass point have different degrees of freedom. So therefore it is the exact dynamics or solution of this system will be very complex, but we can approximately convert it into a generalized single degree of freedom system by assuming a deformed shape, or by assuming the shape of vibration, fixing the shape of vibration first. So let's say that now the UG is applied here, and under that UG the structure is going to have two kinds of displacement. One is the rigid motion because of the shaking of the base itself, and the other one is the actual structural displacement. The second figure here is showing us the inertial forces which are basically developed in that structure because of that ground shaking. Those inertial forces will have some variation, and basically we have to calculate those forces. I will explain the third figure later, but let's assume that you have a tower structure which is subjected to a ground motion. So now the total displacement of the structure, U total, will be basically the structural displacement plus the ground shaking. This UG will be the rigid body motion, the ground, actual shaking of the ground, plus on top of that you will have the structural displacement. Now the idea is that we describe this U of x comma t as a product of an assumed xi of x times the z of t. Okay, so here you will have z of t. So now there can be several you can say candidate functions which can be used as xi of x, because now we have to assume a deflected shape. So there can be several candidate functions. One is this one, a polynomial function. There is another function x square over l square. a trigonometric function also. If you plot all three of them, they will be basically like this. They will be giving you a curved shape in which this tower can deflect. But obviously, we don't know exactly which is more, you can say, appropriate. But one thing these candidate functions should satisfy is the boundary conditions. For example, here in this fixed support cantilever tower structure, you will have a boundary condition, and that is that the displacement at this x equal to 0 should be 0. So the function value at x equal to 0 should be 0. So I can say that xi of 0 should be 0. Okay. And you can see here that all of these three candidate functions are selected such that they satisfy this equation. So if you put x equal to 0, you will get xi of 0 equal to 0. So they all will start from the 0 value, and as the x will increase, they will have some non-zero values. So they all are the candidate functions to represent the shape of vibration of that tower structure. So they are set such that in this example that their peak value is equal to 1. So they are all normalized already. So at x equal to capital L, xi of capital L is equal to 1. That also you can check. You put x equal to capital L, you will have 3 by 2 minus 1 by 2, and that will be 1. Okay. Similarly, x equal to L, you will have xi of L equal to 1. Here also, x equal to L will simply mean that cos pi by 2, because L will be cancelled, and then cos pi by 2 is 0. So you will have xi of L equal to 1. So basically, it is the, all of these three functions will have one value at top, zero value at bottom, but in between them, they will be having different shapes. So maybe one function is like this, one is like this, one is maybe in the middle. But all three, we don't know which is more appropriate, but all three can be a candidate function for the shape of vibration of this tower. So there can be certain other things which you should first keep in mind while selecting the shape function. But most important is that it should satisfy the boundary condition. If you are solving a beam, then obviously you know already that both at x equal to 0, if x is now the horizontal axis, at x equal to 0, you should have the function value equal to 0. And at x equal to L also, you should have the function value equal to 0. So you should select the deflected shape such that it satisfies these boundary conditions. Now let's calculate using any of these shapes. Let's calculate the equation of motion. We know already from D'Alembert's principle that these inertial forces, which are basically the earthquake forces or effective earthquake forces, they are equal to minus mass times the acceleration. And now acceleration at the top of the structure, or the acceleration of the structure, will be total acceleration. Or inertial forces are always the function of total acceleration, not the structural acceleration only. The total acceleration itself is comprised of two parts. One is the actual structural acceleration, response acceleration, and the other is the ground acceleration. This is the rigid body motion part. M is not one constant, but it is the function of x. Now the idea is that if we use the principle of virtual displacements, we can come up with the equation of motion for this tower structure. Ideally, it is having infinite degrees of freedom, but we can convert it approximately by fixing this xi of x into a generalized single degree of freedom system. So the principle of virtual displacement states that if a system which is in equilibrium, if it is subjected to any vertical, any virtual displacement, and that is delta u of x, they are virtual displacements. The external work done in having this displacement delta u of x should be equal to the internal work done. So this internal work done is represented as delta w I, capital I, and external work done is represented here as delta WE. If we can equate these two work done, then we will see that that equation will basically become the governing equation of motion for this tower structure, and that will look like the single degree of freedom system equation with modified mass, modified damping ratio and modified stiffness. So here let's put that, let's calculate the external and internal work done and then let's equate them. The external work done by the effective earthquake forces is simply equal to the forces itself times the virtual displacement. So we give the virtual displacement to our structure, and they are hypothetical displacement, virtual displacement, and we are calculating the internal work done in undergoing these displacement and external work done because of basically corresponding to these displacement, and then we will calculate, we will equate them, and then we calculate the equation of motion. Basically that equation will become the equation of motion for this system. So we know already that external work done is simply equal to the forces, external forces, the earthquake forces in this case, times the virtual displacement. So force times displacement, obviously we have to integrate it now because it is not one fixed force, it is the variation of force. So Fi is not a constant now, it is along the height of the structure, it is varying and it is variable, you can say effective earthquake forces. And delta U is also the function of X, because we didn't give it one fixed displacement, it is the virtual displacement which is varying along the height in the same manner. So delta U of X at any particular height times the force value at that height, when you multiply them you get the work done, but you have to integrate it along the whole height to calculate the total external virtual work. So this is the total work done, external work done in undergoing the virtual displacements delta U. The external work done can be further simplified because we know that this Fi is equal to, we have already calculated in last slide, it is equal to this whole thing minus mass times the acceleration, and that acceleration is total acceleration. So it is having two components, one is the actual structural acceleration and other is the ground acceleration. So you have that Fi x comma t. So you put that whole thing here, and obviously it has two components, so the integral will also be split into two parts. One will be having u dot dot, which is the structural acceleration, and other will be having the u dot dot g, which is the ground acceleration. Since the ground acceleration is not the function of x, so it will be coming out from that integral, and inside that will be m of x and delta u of x. So m of x is the variation of mass along the height, delta u of x is the variation of virtual displacement which we have given to our structure along the height, and u dot dot x comma t is the structural acceleration along the height. So the internal work done is due to the bending moments. Let's represent them with m x comma t. Those bending moments will also be the function of both along the height as well as in the time fluctuation, and obviously those bending moments, their corresponding deformation is the curvature. So we can calculate the internal work done by multiplying the curvature with the bending moment, you can say, and then we integrate them for whole of the height, which is from 0 to L. The bending moment is represented by m x comma t. Let's represent the curvature as delta k of x, where delta k of x is the virtual curvature. Virtual curvature, and that is basically corresponding to the virtual displacements. We have given our structure the virtual displacements delta u, and also the corresponding virtual curvature will also be there. So we represent that as delta k of x. It is the double derivative of displacement, because we have defined the curvature as, if u is the displacement, then curvature is double derivative of displacement. So we know already that curvature is the double derivative of displacement, d2u over dx square, where x is the length of the element. So here also, we know already that we have defined such that if u is the displacement, then u double prime is basically d2u over dx square, where x is the length of the element. So this is basically delta d2u over dx square. So this double prime is basically the virtual curvature, delta u double prime of x. The moment, on the other hand, can be written as ei into actual curvature, because from bending equation we know already from basic mechanics that bending moment is equal to ei times the curvature, which can be represented as phi. So the moment curvature relationship for an elastic structure will have the stiffness equal to ei. This phi can be written as u double prime, and therefore the mx comma t can be written as ei of x. Ei of x is itself a variable now, and u double prime x comma t. So we know already that u double prime is curly 2u over curly x square, which is basically the second derivative of the displacement. So if u is the displacement, then double derivative of displacement is the curvature. So here we were calculating the internal work done, and that internal work done is equal to the integral of the moment, bending moment, times the resulting curvature, and that resulting curvature obviously will be corresponding to the virtual displacements. So let's call it virtual curvature, and that will be this whole quantity, this one. And also we have this moment, and that is coming from the elastic bending formula, and that is bending moment is equal to ei times the actual curvature of u. So double prime means double derivative with respect to x, and dot means the derivative with respect to time. So we have also calculated the internal and external work, and we can equate them now. But one more modification which we can do here is that since we have already fixed the deformed shape or shape of vibration or this xi of x function, and we are basically using this equation, u of x comma t is equal to xi of x times z of t. So let's also put this equation in the external as well as internal works. So we will have this u dot dot of x comma t, in fact u prime double prime of x comma t, as the xi of x double prime times z of t, because the double derivative with respect to x will only be applicable to the function, which is the function of x, and z of t will remain same as it is. So that double derivative will only be affecting the xi of x. Similarly, u dot dot, which is also coming in one of the terms here, if I go back, here you can see that you also have u dot dot in the external work done. So that u dot dot can be replaced by xi of x times z dot dot. Now the double derivative is with respect to time, and therefore the xi of x will remain as it is, and double derivative will shift to z of t only. Similarly, you are also having the virtual displacement that can be replaced as xi of x times delta z. Now delta z is the virtual displacement in the z generalized coordinates. Similarly, the virtual curvature is also there. So it is the double derivative of virtual displacement. So if you apply the same identity, same equation, the double derivative with respect to x will only be going to xi of x, and delta z will be like this. So now if we replace these new equation which we have just considered now, this equation, and it's all of these four results, this result, this one, and this one, if we put them in both of the external and internal work equations which we have just derived, what we can do, if I can go back, this u dot dot of x t can be replaced with what? Xi of x z dot dot of t. This can be replaced with this. Similarly, this delta u of x can be replaced by xi of x delta z. Similarly, in the internal work done, you have this expression at the bottom. Now here, this delta u double prime can be replaced. Here you can see delta u double prime, you can replace with this equation. Similarly, you can replace this u double prime here in the back. If I go back, here you have u double prime, you can replace it with xi of x double prime times z of t. So that double prime will be only on xi of x. So the summary is that whenever you have the double prime, it will only be affecting xi of x, because double prime means the second derivative with respect to x. Whenever you have a dot, single dot or double dot, it will be affecting z of t, because it is the derivative with respect to time function. So when we put all of these four quantities, or you can say basic equations or assumptions, in our internal work done and external work done, we will see that the minus delta z will be common from whole of the delta we, and delta z will be common from whole of the delta wi, and the equation will be in this form. Now you can see here the external work done here, m of x u dot dot of x comma t, but here you have m of x xi of x into z double dot, and obviously one xi of x will be coming from here, but you can see here in the other one also that will be replaced by another xi of x and delta z. So you will have xi of x square and delta z is common here. Similarly, the second term also can be, you can say, simplified by putting these four quantities. Internal work also can be simplified by putting these equations, the top one, this one and this one. So finally, when you equate delta e, delta we with delta wi, you will see that this delta z will be cancelled out, because it is the multiplier for both of the work done. And the equation, when you equate them, you will see that now the equation will be a second order differential equation in z. It will have a term containing z dot dot, it will have a term containing z dot, and it will also have a term containing z only. And there will be some constant quantity also, and that will be coming because of this ug dot dot. So the form of the equation will be this one. Form of that equation will be this one. But you have to just come up with this modified mass, because that modified mass will be the multiplier of z dot dot. So now you know that this whole thing which I am encircling now, this whole thing is the multiplier of z dot dot. So let's call it the modified mass, or m prime. Similarly, whatever is the number which is multiplying with z only, this is z only, so you just call this whole thing, you call it as the modified stiffness, k prime. And whatever is the multiplier with the ug dot dot, let's call it as l prime. So if you equate external work done and internal work done, you will get an equation which look like the equation of a single degree of freedom system with a different mass and different k and a different l. Okay, so this delta z will be cancelled out, and we will be left with this equation in z coordinates, and the equation will be simply m prime z dot dot plus k prime k into z, k prime into z, equal to minus l prime ug dot dot, where m prime, k prime and l prime is defined here, and it is not defined like this. Basically, they come from equating the external work done with the internal work done. So that's how we will calculate the modified mass K and L as the function of the shape function which we have just assumed at the start, and also as the function of the original mass, original EI, in fact the original stiffness. So we can also this is the final equation for undamped case, but we can also come up with the damped case also. One thing which we can do is that we just divide it with the generalized mass. So generalized mass will be cancelled out, generalized mass will be here, and generalized mass will also be in the bottom here. So we know already that if we treat this equation as the equation of a single degree of freedom system, then that single degree of freedom system will have mass equal to m prime. That single degree of freedom system will have a k equal to k prime, and therefore it will also have the natural frequency equal to under root k prime over m prime. So we can also come up or calculate the natural frequency of our structure by just dividing them and taking their under root. So let's call it omega n, natural frequency of the structure. So let's call this quantity L prime over M prime by another constant, and let's call that constant as the eta prime. So eta prime is basically L prime over M prime, the ratio of two generalized properties to come up with another generalized property. And obviously K prime over M prime can be written as omega square, and if we want to add the damping term also, that will become simply 2 xi omega and z dot. Obviously the m prime will be cancelled out because actually it is 2 m omega xi into the first derivative of the displacement, which is the velocity. So m will be cancelled out because we have taken it common and we have taken it on the other side. So this equation, final equation, is the simple equation of a single degree of freedom system subjected to a modified ground motion. Now the ground motion ug dot dot is multiplied with this you can say this factor, this new factor eta, and now we will calculate a modified ground motion, and then we can subject that our single degree of freedom system to that ground motion. Once we calculate z by solving this equation, we can, z of t is, let's say, calculated already. We can simply multiply it with xi of x, which we just assumed at the start to calculate these generalized properties. We multiply it with xi of x to come up with the actual u of x comma t. Xi of x will simply distribute that time variation along the height of the structure, because xi of x is a shape of vibration. So that shape of vibration will be multiplied by z of t. Z of t is a time function. So basically you assume that now this shape is vibrating with a time history equal to z of t. So this will complete our response of the generalized single degree of freedom system. So this is the natural frequency if you actually write the equation for k prime and m prime, and then you come up with this expression. So this natural frequency of the structure can also be calculated using this method. But again I repeat that this whole method is as accurate as this xi of x shape function. If this shape function is actually describing the shape of vibration, then this method or this xi will be this omega will be an accurate you can say number. Otherwise there will be some approximation in this whole procedure. So the summary is that we have this equation now. This is our final equation for our tower structure, and we have defined this omega as k prime over m prime, c prime over 2 under root k prime m prime. Basically it is same because xi is equal to c over cc, where cc is 2 m omega. So you can also convert this 2 m omega into under root 2 k m also. You can check that also, because I think let's do it now. Omega is equal to under root k over m. So if we multiply this with you can say here we have 2m omega, 2m omega. So let's put omega equal to under root k over m. So you will be having 2m under root k over m. So this can be converted to 2 into under root mk. So this is, please correct that mistake. So 2 should be out of that under root. So similarly, this factor, dimensionless factor, which is the ratio of L prime over M prime, this ratio is eta, is also known for a generalized single degree of freedom system. So what we have essentially done is that we have mathematically converted our tower structure, which was having infinite degrees of freedom, we have converted it into a structure which is a single degree of freedom system subjected to this ground motion, eta times ug, and this system has a different generalized mass, a generalized stiffness, and a generalized damping constant, and the displacement of that system is z of t. Z of t is also called as the generalized displacement. So this equation 7, or final equation, says that the generalized displacement z of t of the generalized single degree of freedom system due to a ground motion is identical to the displacement response ut of a simple single degree of freedom system having omega n and xi to a ground motion which is now modified, and that is eta times ug of t, eta prime times of ug of t. So everything can be mapped to a single degree of freedom system, and that single degree of freedom system is now applied with a ground motion which is not, you can say, the original ground motion, but a modified ground motion by eta prime. So this is the concept of generalized single degree of freedom system. So once we already have z of t, again we can convert that z of t back to u of t. So we can perform either the dynamic analysis to solve that equation. What was that equation? Z dot dot of t plus 2 xi omega z dot of t plus omega square z of t equal to minus eta prime ug dot dot. So this is our original equation of motion for generalized single degree of freedom system. We have to calculate z of t. One option is that we carry out the step-by-step direct integration method or Duhamel's integral to come up with this z of t, and then multiply it with the xi of x to come up with u of x comma t. Another option is that we invoke the idea of response spectrum, because we are calculating the earthquake response. So although this can be considered as a random loading, it can be considered as the random loading, but this can also be, the equation can be solved quickly by using the idea of response spectrum. That if you already have the displacement response spectrum of that particular ug dot dot, let's say that you have already, this is the d, which is the peak displacement for ug dot dot. Now since you have eta times ug dot dot, so all you can do is that you use the actual response spectrum of ground motion corresponding to your omega, because omega is now known, so you can calculate the time period and take the d. That d can be multiplied by the same factor which is multiplied with the ground motion. So we will come up with the peak value of z directly by using the concept of response spectrum. So since because the actual equation from which the response spectrum is constructed is this one, u double dot of t plus 2 xi omega z dot, u dot plus omega square into u of t equal to minus ug dot dot. So there is no, you can say, this eta factor here in the original equation of simple single degree of freedom system. But in the generalized single degree of freedom system, you have this factor eta. So therefore, you have to multiply the same eta from the answer which is coming from the use of response spectrum. So you multiply this d with eta, to come up with the peak value of Z, this equation, directly using the response spectrum. So no need to carry out the dynamic analysis. You directly pick the peak value of Z of t, or let's call it Z naught. And since this d can be written as a over omega square, so this equation can also be written in that form. So now that peak value of Z can be put back in the same equation to calculate the peak value of u. So this peak value of u will be equal to, this is the peak value of Z times the original function which is used as the deflected shape or shape of vibration. So this is the shape function. So shape function has the variation along the height of the actual structure, actual tower structure. So think of this thing as a constant multiplier which is being multiplied by the shape of vibration to calculate the peak displacement along the height of that tower structure. So this xi of x already was defined in the start. So you just have to multiply this with this eta into d. So it will become your peak value of the actual displacement u naught. Or if the structure is not a tower structure, if it has the distributed masses, sorry, lump masses at different levels, so at any particular level you multiply the value of that function with this multiplier and you get the peak value of displacement at that level. So at any distance j along the height, you can carry out this multiplication to get the peak response. So that's how we can come up with the peak value of response of the actual complex structure by using the idea of generalized single degree of freedom system. And not only response, we can also calculate the equivalent static forces. If we want to calculate those hypothetical static forces which will produce the same peak displacement, we can also calculate that, so that we can only perform the static analysis and we can calculate the internal shears and moments and everything. So let's calculate the equivalent static forces, those external static forces that would produce the same displacement which is caused by the actual ground shaking. So that will be simply equal to, because we know already that EI into the curvature, because we know already that the relationship between the shear and moment is that you take the derivative of moment, you get shear. You take double derivative of moment, you get the actual force applied. So the relationship between the actual force and the resulting shear and moment is simply stated as that you have the first derivative of moment is shear and second derivative of moment is the force. So this equation is simply coming from the classical beam theory, which is telling you that this is the second derivative of moment. So this whole thing is the moment. Moment is EI times the curvature, and curvature is already the double derivative with respect to x. So you take the double derivative of this whole thing, you get the equivalent static forces. There is also another simple way to calculate the equivalent static forces. So either you use that equation on top or this equation 12, you will be able to get the equivalent static forces, which if you apply statically will produce the same peak displacement which this earthquake would have produced. This equation can be further simplified because you know already that this peak displacement in that is equal to eta times into xi of x u of 0 is eta times into d into xi of x. So you can write eta times into d, eta prime into d into xi of x, and then d times this omega n square can also be written as capital A. So final equivalent static forces will be these ones, and these are very simple to calculate. This A will be coming from the response spectrum, or you can simply write it as d times the omega square, and d will be coming on spectrum. m of x is the structural property which is given. This is the generalized eta factor that is calculated as part of the solution, and xi of x is the assumed shape of vibration. So this all things are known now, and we can calculate the effective earthquake forces also. Equivalent static forces also, FSO. The shear along the height of the tower structure can also be calculated, because if we know already the forces along the height, we can just simply integrate them, and that will be shear along the height. And the moment along the height also can be calculated. The equivalent static forces can be multiplied with the moment arm to come up with the moment along the height. If we only know or interested in the base values, the base shear or base moment, in that case the x can be put zero in all of these equations, and then we will be reduced with this equation. So VB naught is basically the value of shear at base, and that is simply this factor, that L prime eta prime in and A, which is coming from response spectrum. The base moment is also sometimes called as the overturning moment, is also this thing, and this is calculated from the equation 14 by putting x equal to 0, and we know that now we have this new constant, and that is this whole integral. So the base moment can be calculated using this equation. So I think I will end here, and then tomorrow or next week we will solve some examples which will be using this concept of generalized single degree of freedom system.